in the Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery. Dr. Abubaker has also authored two textbooks, over 50 chapters, and over 40 scientific articles in peer-reviewed journals. He presents before a variety of local, national, and international scientific meetings, and today he's going to talk to us about the healthcare system in Libya.
Before I get started, I don't know how many of you know what a maxillofacial surgery is. It's a surgery of the face and mouth and the head and neck. I want to thank the organizer, Selma and Jean-Louis, for inviting me. I'm honored to be part of this. Selma asked me, I had like 10 or 15 deadlines of things, and I didn't even think about it, and I said, I'll do it. 10 things to be done, what 11 things not, it's not going to happen. But I had to say that I struggle with it because it's not quite my area of expertise, and I'll get to that in a minute. I also thank the speakers before me. The reason I want to ask them is that they talk about politics. And to be honest with you, I don't know if it's my age or I'm spending too much time in front of the TV. But when you add the politics of the American politics to the Libyan politics, my brain is a mush now. I could not produce anything productive after listening to all that politics. And it's truly, I'm glad there are professional people. And of course, you know, I have to deal with other things. But I'm glad there are professional people to deal with these things, and I thank you for it, so I don't have to say anything related to politics. I also want to say that I have not been back to Libya for at least 3 or 4 years, lost track of how many years. I used to go and participate in teaching in the medical center in Tripoli and even do surgeries in Tripoli. But I haven't done that for the last, like I said, 3 or 4 years. So I have not been on the ground. I do have a lot of respect and to the people there that they go through it day in, day out. I can only imagine. And this people, the physicians and the nurses, they try to keep hospitals open. And in fact, I will give them credit for what I'm going to be talking about today, because even though I'm involved into my local politics, I'm the chair of the oral surgery, I'm the chair in the hospital, so I get involved into the politics of the healthcare system within my institutions, and my institution, both the dental school and the medical school in the hospital, but I have not been involved into directly into the politics of healthcare in Libya. So I'm going to give the credit to the people who are there, not only because they do it day in and day out, but I looked up and tried to find information, and the information that I find that I'll be using in my lecture are information that the expert in the healthcare system in Libya had put together maybe 3 years ago, along with the help of the World Health Organization and some international people. So I thank them for it, and I want to give them the credit for it. And my business of academic, you have to do that, because otherwise it could be considered plagiarism and I'll lose my job. So I have all kind of reason to do that. I started off my topic reviewing what I call the challenges and opportunities. And as I went through the literature and trying to find more information, I found that the word challenges, and I'm sure other speakers use it for a different reason. My personality is such that I don't like to look back as much. And I figure the challenges are blames for everybody. And sometimes, you know, you just go beyond that. So I dropped the word challenges out of my talk. And I want to talk about the future. I want to talk about the present and the future rather than the past. That is in my business. You know, you have to be optimistic, and you have, when you have a success rate of 60%, you look at the 60% rather than the 40%. So what I'm going to do in the next 20 minutes, hopefully I have enough time to do that, is to talk about current need and the critical needs of the healthcare system of Libya. And of course, course, review some of the recommendation that was put together, like I said, I think 2012, about 500 organizers, I'll get to that in a second, and review those. And I think those recommendations, they are even more relevant now than they were 3 or 4 years ago. I found this this slide, and I think this is, it says Libyan healthcare on life support. This is 2013. And I was playing with the slides, and this thing came up somehow, honestly, from nowhere. I think I pushed some wrong button, it came up. I said, oh, yeah, I need that. And I enlarged it, and it does actually suit the situation. In the business of medicine and healthcare, when you're in a life support, you can't stay on it for a long time. You gotta get better or die. And I'm afraid that since 2013, the healthcare system in Libya didn't get better. So it's getting where it's an emergency, not only in the critical care unit or the intensive care, but it's actually in life support. To start off with the basic things that the healthcare system for people that are going to be in Libya, I'm going to keep tracking of the healthcare. Primary care facilities and primary care physicians are the troops, are the soldiers of health and business, healthcare. And if you don't have soldiers, you're going to have a hard time fighting the battles. In Libya, right now, the healthcare facilities and the provider of the healthcare facilities are not there. Some of those closed, some of those in a short supply. There are 1,500 of these facilities for 6.5 million, and this was 2012, so probably going to be even less than that. Healthcare scarce, badly damaged, even the 4 years after, or 5 years after the revolution. Foreign workers who used to help left the country and made the supply of healthcare provider even worse. On top of all that, the conflict brought other issues, mental health care, addictions, and war injuries. These are things that are not even there before the revolution. And now the healthcare system, that the fatigue is even more fatigued and more burdened. Chronic, in addition to the primary care, pregnancy and childhood care is World Health Organization criteria of health and healthcare. They are in dire need in Libya now. And of course, emergency healthcare is also very, very scarce. As a result, the domestic services for tons of people are either not available or not quality. And for some of those that could afford or could go on expense to the government outside, it's costing the government and the society millions of dollars every day. So can it be fixed? Well, let's just see what this is. Meeting that I was telling you about, the symposium, was 2012, and it's more critical now than it was ago. And this is about 500 experts, some of them from Libya, some from outside Libya, got together with a World Health Organization, and they came up with consensus, and they published it into the Libya Medical Journal in 2013. They identified what we call six blocks. This is one of the criteria of the World Health Organization, six blocks. The governors, finance, service delivery, resources, and pharmaceutical and healthcare information. Let's go through this quickly, and hopefully I'll get that done in time for questions. The leadership, clearly, without going to blame, there's a leadership failure and management failure, both before and after the revolution. The recommendation was to have an entity that independent or semi-independent has significant authority to dictate what healthcare issues are and how to address them directly. The healthcare system laws are not updated, or some of them not only updated after the revolution, but not updated way before even the revolution. Restructure the organization structure of the Ministry of Health, it's the same. Ministry of Health, the name was different, but it's about the same for many years past. The medicine, more than anything else, I'm in medicine, you have to have a transparency and accountability. That is not there back, and it's not there now, and need to be reestablished. established independent professional council to regulate medical and healthcare specialties. It's just a mirror image of what we have in this country and what a lot of other Western countries have. They have a legislative body that dictates what, how many years of residency, what kind of training people get. The regulated funds, regulation of the private sector. The private sector people will just open a clinic or a private practice in the past, do it on their own, their way. There's no accountability. There's no laws to govern it. A license for private care health facility and for private care provider is missing. You need to be brought back again, need to be some programs that that encourages private sector, because very few healthcare systems would work only with government system. They all have some combination of government as well as private. The finance side, there clearly need to be increasing finance. And this is very pessimistic about this, because not only we didn't have the adequate money in the system when we had the money, and now we don't have the money, so this is going to be a major challenge. The recommendation of experts is that we have to go up 5%, at least 5 to 6% every year for until 2030 and beyond. And clearly, we're not anywhere there. And with the loss of prices of oil, I'm not sure that money will be there. Human resources. We don't have any database. In fact, there is some numbers from 2012. About how many physicians, how many dentists, how many nurses. We don't have that now anymore. And even back then, those numbers were not accurate. So there need to be some database for workforce Libya to know how many we have and how many we need. Because you can't get anywhere without, you know, a count of your army, of your troops, so to speak. Need to distribute the workforce into, used to be accumulated, in even what we had used to be accumulated in metropolitan areas, rural areas. Either had Korean or had other people from other countries that are some temporary there. So we need to distribute our own local workforce fairly. And we need to kind of categorize staff groups, sub-classification depending on the qualification competency before redeployment. The strategic plan for having workforce had to depend on the data that we need now. So we need. If we say we need 500 physicians or 5,000 physicians, we need to know how many we have now before we could commit to that. We need to recruit, retain, incentivize, regulate, have campaign to have some faith in the system, because people used to go outside the country, even though sometimes some of the services are the same within the country. People don't have confidence in healthcare. Even there are some competent physicians who are trained in the West, have the resources, but people just get sick. They go to Tunisia or they go to Egypt, and sometimes not solely for better care, but just we need to reestablish that confidence in the healthcare system and in the physicians, so we can treat our own people. The pharmaceutical, there's almost non-existent now. The importations, the medications, some of those are not even, they're not probably accurate medications. They're not bought probably from some markets that may be more harmful. Some of them not affected because they're fake medications, so to speak. You need to have strategies to reduce corruption for distribution of medications. We need to figure out a way, maybe even some manufacturing. This is a long-term goal, like I said before, but hey, what does it hurt? Can't drink it's always a good thing to have. Work plan development for drug sector. That is, you can't do surgery another way. Half more of the medications are controlled by, or more of the diseases controlled by medications than by surgeries. Need to establish it. So the healthcare information system, this is the medical record recommendation. Right now, the medical record system in Libya probably goes back to Stone Age. That's really, they don't use the stones, but they use papers, and the papers as bad as the stones for an old technology nowadays. Most countries in the United, most hospitals in the United States by 2017, not most, all hospitals in the United States by 2017 have to be electronic, otherwise they won't get paid by the company for their services. And I have to be there. We need to get started on that and figure out a way to get there at some point in time. electronic healthcare system has a quality assurance. Okay, almost done. I've seen 5 minutes. Thank you. Then the health information system, again, it helps us control the quality that we provide. It allows us to integrate the different parts of the healthcare system. And the last one is the service delivery. The orientation of healthcare system delivery to the outpatient and inpatient setting is very problematic now in Libya, and it's worse every day. Every day goes by, it's just deteriorating. A lot of physicians are leaving or are quitting. They're just the delivery part. Even if we have a system, we have the resources, the system is not, it doesn't lend itself to, you know, efficient and adequate delivery. One of the things that need to be done, as I said before, these are the soldiers, the primary care physicians. Nobody wants to go to primary care physician, Lydia, at least in the past, and we need to incentivize people. We need to maybe have higher salaries, high incentive, higher training, all kind of activity that attract people into a primary care system, because that's the backbone of any medical system is primary care physicians. I think I got the 5 minutes. Didn't even breathe. In conclusion, the healthcare system is in a dire need for revival. And you know, while we're waiting for our political system to get better, there are people dying every day. And the sad thing is people dying of illnesses that they, you know, civilized were, people stopped dying of those diseases. You know, appendicitis, people don't die of appendicitis anymore. People can't get to the hospital, or can't get to facilities. I came from very rural areas, and I hear and talk to my family on the phone all the time, and people don't have doctors for about 100 kilometers or 150 kilometers. It's really a dire need, and we need to start doing CPR, but not in the ICU anymore. We must start doing CPR in the healthcare system. I'm not sure we should wait until the government, until the politicians get their act together. There are a lot of challenges, even if we start today. I'm so afraid that by the time the politicians get their act together, there'll be a lot of people, a lot of human suffering, a lot of human casualties. And not only that, it's going to be so hard to bring it back into a meaningful shape. Like I told you, I'm an optimist, though, that we could do it. It can be done. The good news is that once the politics at least cool off, physicians and healthcare provider and healthcare expert and one health organization that are not political organization, they will jump in and come in the first day. There is some sense of security and some sense of assurances, and they would help. And I have a very optimistic view that the international organizations and the international community would be very quick to help with that revival. And thank you very much, and I'll answer any questions.
Rehabilitation and like finances that go strictly towards like your healthcare system, and is that still in effect after obviously the revolution?
Well, everything that the healthcare system hasn't changed much since the revolution, other than the resources you're talking about. Resources, well, I mean, it's changed a lot, but the structure hasn't changed. In other words, whatever available before is available now, except that there is less of it. And there are less physicians, less of nurses, less of support healthcare worker, less of money to provide that care. But yes, the kind of the idea is there, but that's about it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I points that you made about how dire the situation is. I spend a lot of time on Twitter, and I took the train from New York today. So one of the tweets that I read earlier was from a doctor in Tripoli Central Hospital, and he wrote, "This is an emergency call from my Tripoli Central Hospital. We are in crisis. Most of the drugs are finished. The elective surgery was stopped." His second tweet was to the international community, and he wrote specifically to Martin Kobler, who is the special representative. And he said, "What Italian or international community did is not enough. We are working in collapsed hospital. Most of stock aren't finished." I saw a friend yesterday on Facebook calling out for anyone who had access to a particular chemotherapy drug from her husband's uncle. It is just a disastrous situation.
The sad thing is that when you get to Twitter and some advanced social media, but what I find appalling, to be honest with you, even from the international media, is that there's nothing. I mean, I watch CNN, I watch local news. There's nothing on this crisis that are occurring now that people dying of diseases that they shouldn't be dying from in 2016. But there's no coverage for it. There's more coverage of the negative side, which is the political fight and the political crisis that we have, than the healthcare, dire situation. Thank you.
I have a question. I see that the telehealthcare is bad.
The what?
The healthcare.
Yes.
Is bad.
Very bad.
Yeah. So what is the statistic right now about people that are saying that if the doctor could come back, it would be better? Or people who think that what they have now is bad?
How bad?
How bad it is.
It is very bad.
But comparing to the doctor, you can compare with what happened now. How bad it would, let's say if the doctor would come back now, would they be better?
So there's a lot of statistics and some data up to 2013, 2014, because there was an attempt after, the revolution to really start building it. But say since 2013 or 14, there's not a whole lot of data that I can tell you how many people dying of specific diseases. But I know just anecdotally that you hear about stories that if this thing could happen, then the major things, there's no transplant, there are people that have dialysis center that closed, so people have to go to different places or leave the country for dialysis. So there's no accurate picture that could be presented in sense of numbers. And maybe that's why the media have not gone to Libya, the international media have not gone to Libya to convey the actual picture, because there isn't any kind of coverage or adequate coverage, mostly individual coverage. And the central hospital, if the central hospital is having a problem, that's one of the major, if not the major medical center in Libya. I used to go there and do surgeries. And if they have those kind of problems, then you could imagine some of the other small localities, they're probably closed. I know for a fact that some clinics and some communities clinics and a primary care center closed because they don't have, not only they don't have the resources of the medication, they don't have the doctor, they don't have the nurses anymore. But there's no accurate picture to tell you exactly how bad it is. But it's very bad. It's better than you can imagine. Yes?
Me?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, again, one of the important issues, and you're rightfully talking about the lack of coverage in the international media. And I think part of the struggle is to bring these dire issues to the attention of the public, even on a university level. But I guess the problem is, and you've pointed that out clearly, that there is no time to wait for political solutions, and this is dire situation. But then how do you foresee, whether it's in the international community or NGOs stepping in and helping out in this medical emergency without having the stability? I mean, if you have, as the ambassador stated, that governmental officials are being attacked day in and day out, what are the realistic chances of any type of organization stepping in and putting the foundation for a sound medical care providers for the Libyan people?
Very good question. And I do surgery, so usually if it's a good question, I have a good answer for it. I don't have a good answer for this one. And my sense, this is a personal sense, I have no data, no professional views of it. My sense is that the international community are hands-off altogether. And hands-off the politics, hands-off the social issues, hands-off the medical issues. And it's, so the people that are struggling to come to consensus among each other, they forget that. They forget that there's human suffering beside or behind their suffering to get to the best positions or to come up with some kind of solution, political solution to the country, that the price to it is just not one person lost a position and one person gained a position. The price of it is that their families that lose their loved ones from diseases that are just simple diseases, like you can't have medication, your blood pressure, you can't get your blood pressure medication, it's possible that you could get a stroke in 5 days. If you don't get your diabetes medication, you could die in a week. And I'm sure the stories are happening now, that there's no way to cover them, there's no way to bring them out to the community. And my sense is that, unfortunately, that even if we bring them in anecdotally, well, people don't travel, I mean, the international media doesn't travel as much to Libya. I mean, I hear about everywhere except Libya. And I listen to the radio NPR, I listen to watch TV. There isn't anything in that. And until that brought up, I think there'll be no help from the international community. I'm totally an optimist, because otherwise I can't do surgeries, I can't get, you know, things done. But I find myself not wanting to think about these things, to be honest with you. Yes, sir. Yeah, you can go ahead. I repeat the question.
Yeah. Thank you very much. For the international community, by experience with interacting with them, I'd say that they're not just hands-off, waiting, disinterested. They're puzzled, to not say that they're clueless. They don't know how to engage with Libya. My question is, what do you recommend to get these medications and the capacity to the people in need? To my knowledge, Médecins Sans Frontières is a fantastic organization. They're only present in Zuara right now. They can't even travel to Tripoli by road. The road is too unsafe. Right. The reason why you don't see journalists is because if you have people like me go to Libya today, most likely I will quickly get transferred to people that will host me for free and eventually will give me a treatment that is not very healthy. that's the reason why you don't see foreign workers today in Libya. Now, there are people, you say in Tripoli, the situation is dire. Nobody, a friend asked me, we need medication. I don't know how to get it to them. So how do you advise the international community to actually get the medication to the people in need? Empowering which mechanisms, through which channels?
You're asking a political question. Because I think
it's a difficult one.
Because without safety, you know, even the best activists and healthcare volunteers, without some sense of security, they won't be able to go there and provide the system. And there's no trust that if you just send it, it'll get there. And I think that's a fundamental failure in the society, is the lack of trust. To be honest with you, this is part of our politics. Lack of trust that the other person had the same goals. So if you send, I have that asked me if I can mail them some medication. And if I mail them, they won't get it. So the same thing for an international organization. I suspect that they don't trust that if they ship, you know, 2 tons of hyperpressure medication, that's going to get there. From what they hear, from maybe the reality, is that if it gets there, it gets picked up, and it goes somewhere else, not to the people that he sent it to. It's a fundamental flaws that this, I call it a virus of relationship, which is lack of trust. And I think lack of trust is good everywhere you look at it. Our culture here is built on trust. So when I say built on trust, meaning that when I talk to you, I assume that you're intentions or Trust your intentions are good ones, so we're going to interact with you peacefully in a civilized way. If we don't have that, I can't even talk to you. Yes.